Welcome back to Barefoot Math. Today I'm going to tell you about monotone coupling from the past, an idea developed by myself and David Wilson, but mostly David Wilson, back in the 1990s. Before I tell you about coupling from the past, let me tell you about a related card trick called the Kruskal count. The magician shuffles a deck, lets the subject shuffle the deck, and then says to the subject, "I want you to lay out these 52 cards in a row. And when my back is turned, I want you to touch one of the first 10 cards in this ordering of the 52 cards. That is your first key card. Put your left finger on the key card, and now take your right finger and move it the number of positions past the key card equal to the value of the key card. So, for example, if the card you chose as your first key card was a 5 of any suit, move your right finger 5 positions to the right of your left finger. The card your right finger is pointing at, that is the second key card. Put your left finger on the second key card, look at the value of the second key card, and move your right finger that many positions beyond the second key card to find the third key card. Aces count as 1, jacks count as 11, and so on, usual sort of numerical interpretation of the face cards. And then, when you reach the end of the deck, you will find a key card that you cannot go beyond because your right finger will run off the end of the deck. That last key card is your tapped card. Tap on that card just so you don't forget what it is. Make a note of what it is. And then tell me I can turn around. And amazingly, I will be able to tell you what the tapped card was. How does the trick work? I'll tell you at the end of the video. But first, I have to tell you about monotone coupling from the past. But before I do that, let me show you the sorts of things you can do with coupling from the past. Here is a picture created by David Wilson of an equilibrated easing model state at a critical temperature on a rather large grid. Now, this picture, when it was created in the 1990s, was rather sensational because nobody had been able to that date to get really good samples that were exactly satisfying the requirements of a certain probabilistic distribution called the critical state of the equilibrium of the easing model on such a large grid. And the way to do it was to use coupling from the past. So let me switch now to a toy model. It's the simplest picture I can think of that illustrates the key idea of coupling from the past. This is going to be a random model where you toss a coin 100 times to decide what should happen to a certain token that starts out at the middle position on this ladder that has 3 rungs in it, a bottom rung, middle rung, and top rung. So we start the token at the middle rung, and then we toss a coin. Every time the coin comes up heads, the token moves up the ladder by one step if it can, or stays put if it's already at the top. So I'm actually going to move that token not to here, but to here, because 1 unit of time has passed. We're now at time negative 99. Now we toss the coin again, and maybe the coin comes up heads again. So the token cannot move up any further, so it just stays there. But if the coin had come up tails, then we would have moved down one step. So I hope the rules of this game are clear. We start here at the middle rung. We toss coins 100 times, let's say the last 2 tosses come up tails, and so maybe the token is here at time negative 2, and then it goes down one step to time negative 1, then it goes down another step, and it ends up at the bottom rung at time 0. So what monotone coupling from the past lets you do is effectively determine the output without doing all the work. In this particular case, where the last 2 coin flips came up tails, we can sort of see that we don't actually have to know anything that happened before time negative 2, because regardless of where the token is at time negative 2, it has to be at the bottom rung at time 0, because these 2 consecutive tails as the last 2 steps drive it there. Check it out. We've already seen that if it starts here, it ends up here. If it starts here at time negative 2, then at time negative 1, it's down here, and since it can't go any lower, tossing a tail just causes it to stay there, so it's still at 0. And it's still at the bottom rung. And finally, If the token is here at time negative 2, just stays put and stays put again. So that means we really only have to do two coin flips and not a whole lot of moving a token around to effectively sample from the distribution associated with the full honest game that starts with a token in the middle rung and then does 100 steps of simulation. Now, there's only a 1 in 4 chance that the simulation ends with two tails and only a 1 in 4 chance that it ends in two heads, which would also result in the token being in a definite position, namely the top position. But we're bound to get something like this happening pretty late in the simulation process from time negative 100 to time 0. So here's my recommendation to you. In fact, let's change to the pessimistic scenario where these two flips are different. So go from time negative 2 to time 0 using two different values of the state of time negative 2. One of those values is the top state, and if you go tails, heads from there, we end up in the top rung. And starting from the bottom position, if we do tails and then heads, we end up in the middle position. So we have failed to identify what the state of this game is at time 0, but we have learned something. Namely, we have learned that if we had done the simulation honestly, we would end up somewhere between these two states. And that's because this simulation scheme has a certain monotonicity property, hence the word monotone. Specifically, if we have two different positions of the token at time negative n, and we run the simulation forward from time negative n to time 0 with those two different positions, if the token in the first simulation starts above the token in the second simulation at time negative n, then that relationship is preserved at time 0. The first token is above the second token. Now here I have to be a little bit careful. When I say above, I mean above or at the same position as, or numerical terms greater than or equal to. So if the vertical position at time negative n in one simulation is above the vertical position of the token in another simulation, that property, above or in the weak sense, above or at the same position as, that property is preserved all the way to time 0. So in particular, since the position of the pig at time negative 2 has to be somewhere between the bottom position and the top position, once we get to time 0, if in fact the last two coin flips cause the top position to go to the top position and the bottom position to go to the middle position, the result of the honest simulation would have to result in the token being in one of these two positions. So here's the way we can do coupling from the past. If simulation from time negative 2 doesn't work, go back to time negative 4 using two new coin flips. Maybe they're tails and heads, or I don't know what, tails and heads. And then use the same two coin flips we used before, from time negative 2 to time negative 1 and time negative 1 to time 0. The outcome is going to be either a single position in the range between here and here, or again, two positions that lie in this range. And in the case we don't have coalescence of all those histories, we go back to time negative 8 and then time negative 16 and so forth, doubling it each time, time negative 64. If simulating the system from time negative 64 to time 0 doesn't result in coalescence of the two histories, one of which starts at the top state at time negative 64, and the other which starts at the bottom state at time negative 64, then shrug and do an honest simulation from time negative 100 to time 0, starting in the middle state. Now, in that unlikely event, you have wasted some time doing these partial simulations from time negative 1 or time negative 2 or time negative 4 or time negative 8 to time 0. But that's incredibly unlikely that all those attempts have failed. So even though in principle you might end up wasting time, it is overwhelmingly likely that one of these much shorter simulations will actually give you the same answer as the long simulation would have done. Now you can ask, what if we hadn't stopped when we got to negative 100? What if instead of shrugging we'd gone back to twice 64, negative 128 steps, negative 256 steps, and so on? Well, then in a certain sense, we are sampling from a process that we can think of as running from time minus infinity to time 0. And that's where this sort of picture comes in, because this picture is sampled from the stationary measure of a certain Markov chain, which you could get if you could run the system for infinite time. And the innovation here is that instead of thinking of running from time 0 to time infinity, you run the simulation from time negative infinity to time 0 and try to figure out what that should mean. That's all I'm going to say about monotone coupling from the past. I do have to explain how the Kruskal trick works, but I'm sure many of you have already guessed. Just as these simulation histories coalesce over time, so too with the Kruskal count. So even if two different people doing this trick at the same time might make two different choices for their first key card among the first 10 cards, there's a decent chance that their second key card would be the same, and even better chance that their third key card would be the same. So by the time you get the end of the deck, there's a very good chance that the last key card would be the same. So what the magician does is just choose the first card, the one all the way at the left, from the subject's point of view, as their key card, and then figure out what their tapped card would have been if they had followed this procedure, because with very high probability, their tapped card would be the same thing as the subject's tapped card. That's all I got. Thanks for watching.